the last session, and I was speaking in an agile conference last year, and there's a lady sleeping right in front of me, so there's a very high chance that might close up. Secondly, I recently had my second baby who is 8 months, so I tend to make him sleep very often, so I speak in a lullaby, so try not to sleep. Okay, giving my introduction, I've been a stand-up comedian till some time since start of my professional career. I do a little bit of street photography, and I have a trained theater actor, but this is nothing to do with what I speak. This is my day job. I do a bit of coding and I speak. The last session was excellent, but mine is going to be very different. You know, we'll have to dig deep into devices and find out why IoT works. Might turn out boring at times. In case it you need to listen at a higher abstraction level, show me somehow that I'm going to go deeper, okay? This is nothing that I've studied, it's all that we are implementing at Cognizant. I work as a senior architect there. There's a new unit formed, it's called an IoT, Emerging Business Accelerators, and IoT is one of the units. And I've taken a lot of examples. Let's see if it all makes sense. IoT, so everybody knows what IoT is, right? The very common examples. The kind of theme I'm going to take is a little different. It's that IoT is getting famous because of the DIY thing, you know. The Arduino boards or the Raspberry Pi boards, and you can make sensors work. You can make your fans and lights and HVAC systems control. It's a very different ballgame at an enterprise level, some of which Brain has covered. So when you're talking about the high scale things, I'll wait. I used to teach in an engineering college, so you know, I need a little bit of discipline. Can you please be excited? Please. So, yes, where was I? Yeah, when you talk about enterprise systems, it's a very, very difficult thing to get data, and as he said, to secure data, to keep it in regions, especially in the medical domain. I think there are 3-4 domains that are getting famous. One is automotive, one is medical, connected healthcare, connected hospitals. We'll take one of the examples, and we are failing miserably in print, I must tell you. We're failing miserably for the security aspects. We've tried almost everything that you said, but it's very difficult to comply to European standards and have data in a particular region and not show to others who are trying to access it. It's terrible. But let's go forward. So what I'm trying to, yeah, so the theme I'm taking is getting out of the DIY stage, okay? Thing in the enterprise architecture sense. When you talk about devices sending data, devices do not send data. You have to get the data, grab it, make sense of it, do the semantic annotations, make it to a level where devices can understand, okay? Any kind of, the platforms can understand, the business application can understand the data. But it's good to say that devices send data, but they don't send, trust me. So that kind of enterprise-y world I'm trying to show you here. Most of the startups working in IoT space love it because of the kind of experiment and the results that IoT gives you. The satisfaction of working on the boards. Myself is an electronics engineer, so you like that soldering and wires and the data getting coming up and show visualizations. But on the enterprise side, it's not so interesting. So all definitions you'll find everywhere. At a very high level, Internet of Things are 3 things. They have 3 paradigms in which you can think about it. I'm trying to take you from very broad, higher up level. Don't take me. They take you from very broad, high level, simplistic view of IoT, and will slowly get into device architecture, cloud architecture, IoT platform architecture, and then the problems associated with the deployments. You know, I was working with Swaroop. Swaroop is sitting there. We're working in one of the labs together. And we just used to think about where to place this component. Ye app server karega, ye web server karega, where to keep things. In IoT, it's a very complex ballgame. So there are 3 paradigms. One is internet oriented. Why internet? Because suddenly everything is connected. Nothing was always connected. Because of the RFIDs, the active passive RFIDs getting famous, they are sending data. Because of ZigBee protocols, Z-Wave protocols, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, 3G, everything can send data. And because of analytics and big data, they can make sense out of any data. That's why it is getting famous. So a lot of it is about the connectivity thing. Second paradigm is the things oriented. As I said, every possible thing can be connected now. We have been hearing about this since yesterday. But even the hospitals, I'll take this example, that's why I'm giving you a reference of it. Hospital equipments, huge hospital equipments, do not earn by the equipment, by selling the equipments. They earn when they sell the reagents, when they sell the bottles. You know, the printers, HP doesn't earn much through printers. It earns through acquisitions. So that's what it happens. So they need to constantly monitor the medical devices around the world to see kiska reagent kam ho raha hai, where to push it, whether it is put in the right department or not, is it sellable or not, but kind of so getting data from all over the world. So, yes, third is semantic oriented. So, specifically an example of smart cities or the larger things where there's more diversified kind of sensors and devices are present, all kinds of data come. Data comes in all sizes and shapes and manners, right? You need to semantically annotate the data. You need to define the, what you call as a ontology of the data so that it may starts to make sense. So I have, I think in the appendix, probably I have one of the slides where it shows the knowledge hierarchy. You can find it on the internet also. Raw data and then to actionable intelligence, what stages it goes through. That comes in the side of semantic-oriented kind of things. Broadly, it's all about having a situation awareness and decisions based on it. Simple architecture, nothing too complex. It's all about devices, connectivity, platform, because you need to gather the data, control the devices, and then the applications. It can be situated, deployed anywhere. This is a simplistic view of how everything can be. Devices generally are of three kinds based on the connectivity. They either are themselves connected, which are Wi-Fi enabled, or the GPRS, the GSM connected devices, or they are dumb devices and need gateways in front. They can communicate to a certain very small range. Very interesting project we did for, I cannot speak the names. So for one of the public toilet makers in the European world, where they want to have a feedback system, touchless feedback system. They want to have touchless, obviously. So they're public toilets and people want to tell, they want to listen from people whether they clean or not. How do you tell them? You know? They don't want people to touch their device, you know, never know what kind of hygiene they have. So they had an NFC, which is a near field communication, where a person could wave his hands and you could have an LEDs. If he stays his hand in a particular position for 2 seconds, it will register that many number of ratings of whether the toilet was clean or not. And that local device is connected to a hub which connects to a few public toilets. It can communicate to a certain region, and that hub then sends all the data to the data centers, where the intelligence runs as to how many negative feedbacks a person gets, all the kind of social intelligence, how much is the usage, how what percentage is it negative, and then they start cleaning the whole things. So, yeah, so there are devices that do not directly connect. They connect to local hubs using probably ZigBee, Z-Wave. There are so many more other devices. You might have heard of it, I'm not sure. ZigBee and Z-Wave both are high frequency protocols of short range. I think ZigBee does it till 10 meters and Z-Wave does it till 30 meters or something. So they connect to the nearest port, nearest hub gateway, and then gateway connects to the internet. And yeah, so in this case, a gateway could be proprietary. Like there's a company called iControl which does home automation. So their devices are their own devices, their hubs are their own devices, they can talk to each other with proprietary protocol for whatever reasons, and then that connects to the gateway, internet gateway, and to the wider network. Platforms is a very interesting subject. As you mentioned, everybody is calling themselves as an IoT platform, they're giving IoT platforms. Even Intel is saying that. Interestingly, Intel doesn't do anything beyond boards, and they still say that they have a if you go to the site, they say they have an IoT platform along with Wind River. Wind River just helps you do farm boards to provide this kind of connectivity, pseudo connectivity here. So platform is a very interesting topic. Microsoft came with the first platform, I think, parallelly Axeda and ThinkWorks, Axeda. These are two platforms. Microsoft ISS is now defunct. I want to take that example, but it's not. They have taken it down now. And Amazon is another. So Amazon is a federated kind of platform. They do not do everything end to end. So you can use some of their components and make an IoT platform. So it's not as a business application are typically in-premise applications that want to use data that are existing and make sense for the business users. It's a very big bothersome for applications to connect to platform, by the way. Very technology agnostic view. All things connected, home, power, auto, again, televisions or hospitals. These are the things we are talking about. They do some kind of local analytics to decide what kind of data to send. They send the data to internet, and this goes to either the in the platform analytics or outside, which gives business sites, business insights or operational feedback to control these systems. So broadly, completely simplistic picture is this. As you see, we are getting slightly more complex with each slide. So hold your hearts, it is going to get more complex. This is clear, right? Any doubts, anything you want to talk? That's simple, correct? So why it is going simple, you can ask. When it gets more complex, it is difficult to ask. No questions? Good. I don't want to be a sermon, so if you can speak, that's good. Typical categorization of things, as I said, could be consumer electronics, medical devices, sensors, gateways. Connectivity could be any of the protocols. How to make it secure, how to send the data securely is a very different challenge. Once we come to a reference architecture, we'll talk about it. Then it's cloud. It depends, it could be a private cloud, public cloud. Either way, there's a bigger problem about doing converting this, sending this data into data models, and doing the device, registering the device, deregistering the device. What if someone attaches his own device into a gateway? How do you identify it? All kind of things happen here, and then this is the remote visualization part, final, which has predictive analytics. And everybody speaks about predictive analytics. Do you guys have any experience? Has anybody spoken? I was not here yesterday. About how predictive analytics work. Anyone, any idea? Predictive maintenance of industrial equipment. It's a very interesting thing. So these slides, Harshad asked me to bring, so I brought it. But let's try to understand the concept. Even if I don't go with the slides, I want to convey what I'm trying to convey, all right? So predictive analytics is a very interesting thing. That's why I'm talking about it. We did a small POC for a company which had, if you see, there are buildings of the size of 100 or 150 floors in the Western world. They have huge doors that are motorized, huge glass doors that continuously move around. And they break down quite often. Traditionally, there is a breakdown maintenance, which is called, there's a word that's there for maintenance. And then there is preventive maintenance, which is about every 3 months or 6 months, these doors go into the manufacturer's place for maintenance. There's something called third kind of predictive maintenance, because all doors are not used similarly. So what we did was, we put some sensors into the doors. There were two kinds of data streams that come from the doors. What we get is the operational data. Operational data means if it is what's the torque of the data, what is the speed of it, what is the hold time, what is the wait time, how much force the door is pushed on. All kind of operational data flows from those doors to our systems. And then the second kind is their constructional data, which is about the manufacturing data. What is the weight? What is the hinge sizes? How much pressure do they bear? Everything about the construction of manufacturing of the doors. These two streams of data, we construct some algorithms. We actually use machine learning algorithms to guess what should be the right time for it to go to maintenance. That is typically, when I speak about preventive maintenance, this is what it means. You get the operational data, you get the manufacturing data, you do number crunching, you find out what is the right time for the maintenance. So that's an AI kind of machine learning algorithms that you use there, typically structured. Simple case, I don't know, I just heard from her that this was covered yesterday. This is what we had done, so I'll still speak. This is a BP machine, which is Bluetooth. This is a very simplistic POC we have done. It's a BP machine. What it does is, the idea is to have a remote healthcare monitoring, so the patients can be monitored by the doctors when they are obviously at their homes, for elderly or whatever. So they carry the BP, through Bluetooth, it gets converted, it gets sent to an application in a phone, Android, iPhone, or whatever. And this guy acts as a gateway. So it conforms to the larger architecture that we talk about. This gateway through cellular network or Wi-Fi gets to the cloud. We use Windows Azure for it. This here, we have a kind of a dashboard where the doctor can see what is the BP monitoring thing, what is BP over the 5 days. And interestingly, this is not a healthcare company that wanted it. It's an insurance company that wants it because they want to change the premium based on your lifestyle habits. He can set the medicines and that gets pushed to his phones through the same app, and if he's not taken the medicine, it will give on certain notifications. This is kind of a remote patient monitoring thing. It's kind of a micro example. Connected hospital is an interesting example. What it does is, generally the requirements is to have a, okay, let me explain the situation first. The situation is that there are around 500,000 medical devices, complex medical devices, not smaller ones, ventilators, and each device has 3-4 tests that can perform, 4-5 modules, and each module can perform 4-5 tests. These devices, of the range of around 500,000 these devices across the world in different hospitals. These hospitals, these machines needs to communicate. This company that these machines belong to is in, say, some European company, Germany, okay? This company is based out of Frankfurt and wants to control all these devices. It wants to make a software update. How do you update something that is not in your premise? Over the care updates, that is possible. That's the one we're bringing. One is software update. Second is you want to get the configuration out of it. So complete maintenance of these. This is a huge amount of data that comes, and a huge amount of machines that are connected to. So device configuration through data upload, because the machines sending the data, registration and deregistration of data. How do you make sure the data is secure? How do you? There's a lot of things that goes on. You need to do a proper certification system. We have. An SSL handshake, there's a device generated key by the platform generated key that we use for the platforms. So registration, deregistration data, software updates on the devices, that is data downloads, of the size of 50 GB per device. So how do you do that so quickly that it gets to each of the devices? And then the device health. Supposing a device somewhere in a hospital goes down, you have to fix it very quickly. There are SLAs that we have to cater to. How do we measure whether each device, how to get the heartbeat of each of the devices? The command traceability. I'm sitting at a data center in Frankfurt, and I send a command to a particular hospital, a particular machine, for a data upload. I want to know what kind of patient data it has. So there's a command traceability that is needed. So what point in the whole chain has the command reached? So it needs to send whether in 2 seconds the command has reached the cloud or not. In 5 seconds, whether it has reached the gateway or not, and then at what time does it reach the actual device? The patient data capture and upload, remote troubleshooting, which is very difficult to achieve through remote sharing mechanisms, and then compliance requirements around medical devices. So this is kind of a reference architecture that we have used, and what it shows is the devices which are directly connected and the gateways. You need to have some kind of a service bus to bring that asynchronicity to the large amount of data that is coming. So this heartbeat for 500,000 devices comes every 5 seconds. You need to process it. You need to find out whether some device has died or not. If it has died, you need to actionize it. Might be that some guy needs to do a remote sharing to find out what has failed in the machine. So event ingester is something, it's a technology agnostic term. I'll take an Amazon architecture later. It's something that can ingest a huge amount of data, a stream of data, and sends it to event listener. There are rules in them, for example, how much time the device has not sent data, etc. Rest of the communication goes through a service bus because we need to have queues. Now the problem is, these devices and gateways generally do not have public IPs. They cannot be addressed. Okay? So how do they connect to the platform? There are very specific things. If we say that devices send data to the platform, collect the data, do actionable items, but devices are inside, your own machines doesn't have public IP at home, correct? How do these devices connect to the platform if they don't have HTTP? They don't have a public IP. So these service bus, there's only one way you can do it. They have public endpoints. You only have to implement something called polling. So they have HTTP endpoints. You have to keep on hitting it to find out your data and to send your data. You have to keep on polling it. For larger uploads or downloads, you use something called CDN. You know, I think, what is CDN? Content Delivery Network. So Content Delivery Network can actually sit outside it based on deployment. So there are ingester queues and there are ingress queues and egress queues. It's two particular systems that they wanted. Device management, I'll take it on the later stage too, is about deregistration, registration of devices, upload data and download data. Device configuration is decided by the business application. You need to transfer the data back to devices. Similarly, command and control is about controlling the life cycle of each command, how it goes, how quickly it goes, how much, if it doesn't respond in whatever second. So it's like a state machine you have to manage for each device. And I haven't shown it, you generally use something called cache, elastic cache for Amazon, and some kind of caching mechanism, which stores, it's very difficult, 500,000 devices. You send them commands at a rate of around 2,000 to 3,000 per device, and you have to manage the life cycle of each command to see if it has reached the point or not. And in response to that command, it sends back the acknowledgement to the platform. And you need to maintain the life cycle of command and the response. So that, it's very complex, and you have to bring cache, and then there are questions about disaster recovery and high availability. If that cache goes down, if the whole platform goes down, how do you manage it? Software updates, as I said, through the service bus, you only send the URLs for the CDN where it has to pick up the whole chunk of software. It is generally in the range of 5 to 10 GBs. So you cannot do it. So you need to use something called chunker and chunk it into small different pieces. You use multi-part uploads, multi-part downloads. And then these are cross-cutting concerns you guys must be knowing. So you have storage for the device topology, audit logs, device data, config data, and these are the visualization things. Most of the organizations want some kind of a web or data API out of using this data that you have accumulated. So broadly if you see, it is not just connected health, but most of the architectures would be around this. Most of the, whether it is auto transport or medical or smart cities, you have variety of devices. There will be some concerns which are different because of different kind of devices. If they are different kind of devices, you need some kind of content-based routing. For example, for Amazon, their SQS and SNS are very simplistic queues. They do not do, I'm not sure if anybody is from the EI background here, enterprise application integration background, ESBs. Anybody work on ESPs? So content-based routing is one of the integration patterns. So based on the kind of sensor that is sending data, you identify which queue to send it to, which topic to send it to. Right? So yeah, I think that's about this architecture. Any questions, anything in mind? No? Device management, in particular, as I said, these are devices, these are gateways, these are message queues. There's one thing wrong, I've made it through this, but registration service is generally a request response synchronous service. So you directly connect it as an exposed web service. An exposed web service has a risk of a high security compromise. So you need to have external CA here, because it's a public domain, you need a certifying authority, CA, certification authority, for which you have to install a public key, private key here, and you have to install on the first interaction, it gets private key here, and the first installation gets a public key which confirms. So that kind of SSL handshake has to happen with this guy. There are more requirements around security, like encryption at rest, encryption at transit, digital signature of the packages. So all kind of medical, when you come to the medical domain, there is a huge amount of compliance issues that come. So this cloud storage, generally in case of Amazon, we use it as S3. I don't know if you have used Amazon cloud. S3 is a simple storage service. So S3 buckets are regional buckets. These data this, okay, I'll come to the deployment and then we'll talk about that issue. So these are heartbeat services that you get from the gateway agent, you send it across to the messaging bus. You have a download service, and then this response monitor is something that we talked about. It kind of has a state machine implemented. So it takes care of all the commands and the responses, whether the command has reached here or not, etc. This is similarly, it's a gateway agent architecture. This communication module, command header decides whether which kind of interface it needs. This communication module talks to the ESP there. And this guy stores the exact device information. The device generally is not shared with the system integrators. So device details are not shared with system integrators. You only start from the gateway onwards, where they're very proprietary devices. For security reasons, we cannot snoop into it. configuration typology of the whole set of devices underneath it. So what goes with each command upstairs is device ID and gateway ID. And the, obviously the keys for security reasons. So the gateway always knows which one to direct to. It's typically implemented using two ways. It can be an HTTP interface between device and this, or if it is physically connected in like in hospitals, you could use port forwarding sometimes. Because it is not directly used.
But aggregating that output happens at the gate. So the question is, the three devices, if they send signal that okay, they have some old version and now there is need to update that. So that aggregation of response from the three devices happens at gateway, and gateway sends a one single request or.
Correct. This is all custom implementations. For example, all of them, three of them needs an update. Then the gateway, it's a custom implementation, you have to write it unless you get a response from all the three devices. Because gateway always knows what is connected to it. Gateway is not a generic gateway at the platform level. It resides within each of the hospitals. Okay. So in our case, a US hospital generally has one gateway and three or four devices connected to it. So there are around 65,000 gateways you're talking about. Alright?
These are gateway deployments,
correct. Another bigger issue, okay, that will come in the deployment problem. This is an Amazon implementation of that reference architecture. Amazon, as I said, it doesn't provide a queue or a topics outrightly. It is a federated thing. They have something called SQS, simple queuing service, SNS, a simple messaging, simple notification service. And Kinesis is something called, which is a very new product they have. It's called a streaming analysis tool. What it does is pull an HTTP service, but it can ingest huge amount of data. Within each instance of Kinesis, they have shards, which are hundreds of shards. So it's not typically sharding as in database sharding, but it has the capability to do a streaming analytics on a stream of data. So this data goes through it, notification commands goes through SQS and SNS. We have package distribution, because what happens is, when a package gets uploaded to the from the business applications, package gets uploaded, it's a software package, it will have some kind of metadata. That metadata has to be matched to the device metadata to decide which one gets installed on what devices. Okay? Devices are 500,000, software packages are 250,000. You have to do that kind of a mapping, and within 4 hours, each of the devices must get the whole 10 GB of data. So these kind of requirements need a lot of custom implementation. You maintain a cache and you do it cache with other availability zone. How much of data you keep localized in Frankfurt? How much do you keep in US? What kind of, so there are HIPAA compliance, medical compliance also. Patient data cannot travel across the geo boundaries. This is written K because it uses a Kinesis client. So package, these are these services. Then it has a DynamoDB, which is a NoSQL DB. I'm sure you all must be aware of NoSQL was famous around 2 years back. it can store an aggregate of structure, a denormalized fashion. It can store the whole data, and as long as you need the whole aggregate outside, you use a Dynamo. So device topology is a good thing to store there. RDS is their normal RDBMS database. S3 is a simple storage which can be geolocated. It has S3 buckets across the world. CloudFront, obviously, it's a kind of cache CDN. So you need to integrate with Active Directory for all the security and certificate servers. As long as there's a VPN connection between an Amazon cloud and the gateways, you can use an internal CA. But if it's a public cloud, you have to use an external CA. The immediate problem that we're facing right now to offer to them is they want one of the business applications to connect to any of the devices and do a remote sharing. The problem is, here we solve the problem because this guy is only polling the HTTP service. But with remote sharing, you need to connect to a public IP. You have VNC, so devices have VNC servers. You have a VNC client. And you still cannot connect to it because this guy doesn't have a public IP. And setting up a Cisco VPN across 65,000 gateways is impossible. They'll go bankrupt. That's the only VPN gives you a local address and IP. So there has to be a mechanism, which is very difficult to achieve right now. There's something about OpenVPN also, but not for medical companies, obviously. So these are the operational problems I'm talking about. You know, at the higher world, IoT looks very attractive. At the operational level, it is very, very difficult to implement. This is all clear, right? So I think whenever you get into an IoT project, IoT-specific project, you will more or less see some kind of this kind of priority. It is, I'm talking about medical, but it is mostly just technology. This is domain agnostic also. You need to control devices, and that's the problem. Deployment architecture, very boring, but infrastructure people might enjoy it. But still, you'll have to provide it. And I tell you, even in a company like Cognizant, it's such a huge company, we don't find people who can talk about IoT deployments. Because there are so many angles to it, they will keep on pushing you the standard architectures and telling the customer. Customer is always smarter now. First level of software is already done for across the world. People don't want it now. They have grown themselves so much, they can find faults in an architecture like this. Right? Indian services companies are elephants. Don't move fast. So, after a lot of, and we are going to this customer with Amazon, and it's very difficult to work with Amazon India people too. This is a complete AWS as we talk about. We have VPCs, which are virtual private clouds, and within that we have availability zones. So these are two availability zones. There are auto scaling groups for platform services, for dashboards, for everything. For heartbeat service, you generally have one, and the other one is redundant because you don't only want the devices to send heartbeat to one of the nodes. This is an elastic load balancer for dashboard only. These platform services are all the four registration, upload, download services talk about. Elastic cache, as I talked about, package distribution needs a huge amount of caching to decide which packages are sent to what devices. Master RDS, so these availability zones, what we say is that there are around 9 regions in the whole world that Amazon has. Most of the clouds have 8 or 9 regions. Within that regions, they have availability zones. So one zone goes down, the other one is immediately up. Disaster is when the whole region goes down. If the whole China region goes down, then how do you do that? It's a very different. You have some kind of data losses for certain things. Queuing service, streaming channel storage, CDN logs, these are Amazon provided. So any time you're evaluating a platform to use for certain things, you need to make sure what kind of platform services are provided by them, because their availability is ensured by Amazon, which is very difficult for you to do. How do you sync up the whole amount of SQS? For example, SQS, around 500 requests that are still in SQS. The availability zone goes down, and it is not a managed service. You cannot take all the data and send to other queue. All the SLS goes down. The platform thing, the devices have died. So for those things, I think the IoT platforms still make sense. Their managed services. That's it. Within time. I was talking about this knowledge hierarchy earlier. How do data go through different stages and how much you apply raw data plus structured data when you provide the common data models, abstractions when you provide certain domains onto it, and then finally wisdom which you can act upon. Anyways, so anything, any questions? Yeah, you write some pathetic experience, I tell you. PTC is not, nobody from PTC, right? PTC is not, oh shit, sorry. PTC is, I think broadly, if you might know better than me. They recently bought one of them, I think. They're confused about which one to go ahead with, you know, which one to take forward with. Axeda, we had a very bad experience with. It doesn't scale. It just doesn't scale. So we had a conversion from Axeda to ISS at some time. ThingWorx, I don't have personal experience. We just know that we are reducing the team. But you might have a better view on the roadmap. Microsoft ISS was the best platform because what it provides is reference architecture. It provides the libraries and the SDKs to get into the devices and find out the data. Otherwise, if you have access to devices, in this case we didn't have an access. If you have access to devices, you have to write most likely C, C++ code, even if you are working Java or whatever, C++ code or the device, whatever it talks to get the data, make it into the correct domain model, data model, and do a lot of data crunching to send it to the platform. But what Microsoft does it provides an internal service, those SDKs to get the data. It makes it very easy. Amazon and Axeda, PTC, they're not concentrating on, this is my personal view, disclaimer, they're not concentrating on devices as much. Because devices are generally already present with the customers. They think that as long as you can get the data, the rest of the things work. So, but if you read about the semantic annotations and ontologies, you'll understand that data is in very raw format. You have to do a lot of work to make sense out of this data.
Some devices do come with the SDK.
Some devices
do come with the SDK.
Yeah, they are proprietary SDKs, yes. It makes life easier. But if in,
we have been working with one company, Libelian. They sell a lot of sensors. They have their...
Unless they sell the SDK, you won't buy it right now, at this stage. IoT is slowly maturing, you know. If tomorrow you come up with a product, for example, you have let's imagine a product based on Raspberry Pi, which is a camera, you put it outside your home, it captures the photographs, you can configure it using Twitter, and the photographs go to Dropbox, and you can make sense of the data, how many people move around, how many people waited for 2 seconds in front of a house, and all that. You cannot sell that unless you sell the whole story. Unless people can take data out of your Raspberry Pi easily, they won't buy it. So these most of the commercial sensor providers or specific domain specific nodes that they're providing have some kind of SDKs to get the data.
So we were using it for implementing one project for precision agriculture.
Okay.
And that's where we were like all the sensors were chemistry sensors.
Okay. Yeah. Using Google Glass for industrial shop floor automation. For sending the what is happening on the shop floor to top managers, you're using Google Glass to capture that information and send it across. So it's been implemented for some shop floors in Pune. So yeah, implementations are. You please feel free to leave. I'm talking to you. You only get back. All right.
So are there any pre-built gateways?
Pre-built gateways.
Yeah, pre-built gateways.
Pre-built gateways. You have to define them. They are
no. So my question was in context of, for example, context of my project which we are doing precision agriculture. That was only concentrated for one farm.
Right.
Now a farmer wants to connect all his farms.
Right. So if the devices and its communication is very standardized, we'll probably have nothing but gateways, and they are connected. There's no gateway. Depending on if you want to connect back to the devices. it doesn't have public IP, you need something.
In this case, probably the devices won't need public IP because they are.
You don't need to upgrade the devices also, then also you don't need it. If devices are smart and can store, have storage, they can directly call to CDN and get the updates. Just needs a notification to be sent to them, right? Some kind of push notification.
That will have a
need of gateway. So this gateway is not typical internet gateway that I'm talking about, right? In medical example, this is the normal Linux computer connected
yes.
5 devices.
So in my impression was there will be a Linux gateway installed in every farm. Yeah.
Could be.
Sensors are installed in the land. Every
farm. Because the sensors, if they are not connected to Wi-Fi or the larger internet, you need that connectivity. Yes. We have used that for drones in the US farms. So people want to monitor their whole farms without traveling. So they have some of them have smaller planes, but it costs. So you can have drones circle around and they monitor their farms on there. So
that was over the land. These sensors we installed inside the land, capture the chemical details, the pesticide, how much pesticides are required at that particular point. And so that's why it's precision analytics, optimize resource utilization for agriculture.
Very interesting. Good. I haven't seen anything under the ground. Not until I am fine.
Puri University has a sponsor.
Okay. Excellent.
Sorry. So you said that there were some 60,000 gateways sometimes that are being monitored. So how do you manage this? Like, what's the kind of payload that they send? And how do you handle it?
It's around in the range of 4 to 5 TVs per day.
Okay.
So you need to decide what kind of data you need to persist and what you do not persist.
Okay.
So if it is 65,000, you have 9 regions, you divide that and you have a localized S3 storage. Because you're using Amazon, you don't worry about scaling. They charge you like hell, but you still don't worry about it. As long as customer is paying, you can advise the solution. So the point is that scaling comes easy with cloud. If you suggest something and they say that we want to use an optimized data center, it is very difficult to manage it.
So what kind of payload does each device, just curious, in case you know about that, each device in what kind of payload?
Each information,
yeah, each device.
When you talk about download, something is downloaded to the device. When you talk about upload, something is going from here to there.
Yeah, so you mentioned about the heartbeat every 5 seconds.
Correct. That has very few cases. You just need to send which device ID, which gateway ID, and whether it is alive or not. And security key, of course. And because it is in the public network in Amazon wants, it's a two-way certificate authentication. So you need to have certificate here also and there also. It's installed. And the certificates have to be automatically installed. There are a lot of requirements. So people, you cannot send people to a remote location to install something on a hospital. That's it. All right, guys. Thanks for listening to me.